in God, he wondered. But like Peter, we wonder about what we see and experience in this world. We wonder about things within our hearts. We pray, O Lord, that we will not wonder about your word, but to take it in this morning and to let it rest on our hearts. Your word of new life, your word of your risen Son, and your word of victory over death. Be with us, O Lord. Let our meditations and our words be pleasing and acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer.
Amen.
I think we all have Easter memories of some sort. And what's wonderful about worship and gathering as a beloved community is that we create memories. Memories are those impressions that are left on our hearts and minds, the fingerprints of life left upon us. Memories are both sweet and sour. Memories are both treasured and unwanted. The pleasure we experience from sweet memories is oftentimes a balm that helps to soothe the wounds of those memories that are not so sweet. Humans have been gifted with this wonderful gift of ability to remember, to recall. The experience of life is that of a life that produces raw materials for memories. Memories can be thought of like fabrics, beautiful fabrics. Fabrics that are not so beautiful, tattered, maybe dirty also. Memories are like fabrics. Memories are fabrics that are woven together by the threads of relationships, by the threads of sense, sight, hear, taste. Memories are woven together by the threads of places. And brothers and sisters, today, Easter is a call to remember. It is a call to remember those sweet memories of days gone by, whether they were Easter gatherings or Easter dinners or Easter parades or whatever it may have been. It's a day to recall, but it's also a day to remember God's old story of salvation. It's a time to remember God's victory over death. It's a time to remember God's new story of life beyond the empty tomb. And when we turn to the gospel according to St. Luke, he wastes no time reminding us of the past memories that he had. And he begins that scripture that we heard this morning with on the first day of the week. And so he tosses our memory back to Genesis, the creation story. On the first day, God created heaven and earth. And so we know by listening to the story of Luke this morning that God is creating something new right away. And then we're tossed back in time, not too far, not as far back as Genesis, but we're still in the gospel, and we meet up with this group of women. They're about to go and experience God's new creation. They don't know it yet, but they're about to experience what God is up to on this first day of the week. And we're reminded, we're tossed back into the gospel as they go with spices. Ah, spices, beautiful spices, rich spices. We can smell them, and we're reminded of the story of, yes, the birth of Jesus, where the Magi bring these spices for the burial of Jesus. That's the memory that we have. And then, of course, not too long ago, just a few weeks before Jesus' conviction and crucifixion, there is Mary anointing the beautiful feet of Jesus with that expensive ointment. We remember the stories of the gospel. All that fine golden thread of God's salvation story so this group of women are off. Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and a group of other unnamed women travel with him early, early in the morning. They travel off to the garden, to that tomb that was lent to Jesus, that brand new tomb that was carved out into that cliffside. And what they carry with them is not only those spices and beautiful aromas, but they carry with them the memories of the past 48 hours, the memories of Jesus's conviction, the memories of great fear that as they looked from a distance at the cross and saw their beloved Jesus nailed to the cross, they're heavy with memories. They're heavy with pain and sorrow, but they have one last act of love to carry out for their beloved Jesus. They are prepared to face their painful memories so that they can create at least one more new memory tending to the broken body of their lifeless friend Jesus. But God's plan for a new creation, God's plan for a new creation on this first day of the week shattered the women's plan for tending to what death had left behind. Already God is breaking through with this good news that death will not have a claim on these women's lives. And there the women experience as they arrive at the tomb, God's new creation. It is a tombstone, a place of death where the stone has been rolled away. And that tomb is empty. Women look at each other with disbelief. And at the same time as their eyes were filling up with tears and they were shaking their heads and looking at each other saying, where? They see out of the corners of their eyes the gleaming bright clothes of two agents of God's new creation, two messengers of what God is about to tell them through the voice of these angels that God is getting on with something new here. And they speak to the women, they question the women. Why? Why are you looking for the living among the dead? And these same agents proclaim the resurrection truth of God's victory over death. They say to these women, he's not here, but he has been raised. Yes. He has been raised. And then these same agents of new creation, God's messengers, say to the women, do you remember what he told you while you were still in Galilee with him? Do you remember those stories? Do you remember that profession? Do you remember what Jesus was saying? Do you remember what he said about his life? Do you remember what he said about his betrayal? Do you remember what he said about his death? And now do you remember what he said about his resurrection? And at this very time, the gospel tells us that the women remember his words. Memories came back. Jesus' word could be heard in the deep recesses of their hearts. And so with the spices in their bags and their hands all covered with the beautiful aromas and the good news in their hearts, they return to the 11 disciples that are back, hidden with all the other followers of Jesus. Remember, they were not making themselves visible. They were trembling with fear. And they get back and they tell the disciples what they saw. They speak from their fresh memories of looking into the tomb and being in conversation with God's agents of the new creation. They tell them everything. And the disciples, I imagine them with their arms crossed, staring at the women, wondering where they have been and what did they do to come back with this unbelievable story of an empty tomb and a promise of resurrection and the words of Jesus, they just couldn't make the connection. It wasn't theirs to own just yet. But Peter gets up and he's all excited about proving them wrong. I don't think he wanted to. He runs down to the tomb. Runs to the tomb. And there he looks into the tomb. And he sees that it's empty, and he sees the same burial cloths. But there's no agents of new creation there to talk to Peter. He turns around and he walks back, I imagine, this time, thinking about what the women had said and what he had saw. And he gets back, and the gospel tells us that he wonders about what had happened. And it stops right there. And we too, this morning, in parts of our own lives and in our own hearts, we come to this holy day of Easter, we're wondering about what has happened. We have heard the testimony of the women who witnessed the empty tomb, and we have listened to God's agents of hope and promise, the agents of new creation. And still we wonder on this day of resurrection about the day and about the world that we live in. Because it doesn't seem to be going in the same path, the world and the empty tomb. We remember in our hearts and our minds the past weeks of horrific attacks on innocent people throughout the world, whether Belgium, Congo, Afghanistan, Iraq. We remember all that we've heard in the news. We remember our own local tragedies on the streets of Hartford, individuals struggling with opiate addiction. We remember what we see and hear in the news. We remember the stories that come to us through the voices of our friends, the telephone calls. We wonder, how does it line up? How does this resurrection story and what we're remembering from our life experience line up? Wonder, like Peter, what has happened. Death and loss are before us, and we wonder as we stare ourselves into this empty tomb, we wonder. Priest and author Henry Nouwen wondered. And he wrote on in his diary on the last, he didn't know this would be his last Easter Sunday, and in his diary he wrote this. After looking at Time magazine, which had a feature story on the resurrection, he looked at that cover. The picture of Jesus' face was on the cover, and half of his face was a resurrection story, and half of his face was a story of doubt. And Henry Nouwen, he looked at that picture, and he thought, and he said, I quote, I realized that my faith and unbelief are never far from each other. Let me say that again. What Henry said, he said, I realize that my faith and unbelief are never far from each other. That's what we're talking about, friends, the resurrection story in the world that we live in. Oh, our faith and our unbelief are not far from each other. We wonder about the world we live in. We wonder about the empty tomb. But friends, I'm here not to leave you there in that space between disbelief and faith. I'm not going to leave you there. And Henry wasn't left there either. He was just honest, like all of us. I'm not going to leave you there. I'm not going to leave you lost in the chamber of death. That tomb. I'm not going to leave you, and I'm not going to leave myself staring into the empty tomb. I'm not going to just get stuck there looking for the living among the dead, because that's not where Jesus is. He is risen.
Yes.
He's alive.
Yes.
I'm going to look for Jesus where I'm going. brothers and sisters of a shared memory. We remember the words of Jesus, just as he spoke to those women in Galilee about his life, his death, his resurrection. He has spoken to us through the gospel text. We remember the words. So when we get into this place in between faith and disbelief, we got to go back to the words. We got to go back to those memories, those gospel memories. We got to go back to the words of Jesus where he made promises to his people about the future. Remember his promise? To always be with us. Jesus didn't say, when I'm gone, you're on your own, figure it out. Jesus said, when I'm gone, I'm going to a place you can't just come there yet, but I'll be back, and I will give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. You will know that I am with you. That's the promise. And we remember the power of the Easter memories. How Jesus has gone on before us. How he went on before the disciples, and how they would encounter him on the road to Emmaus, and how they would see him on the beachside, and how he would share meals with them, and how he would go fishing with them, and oh, Jesus was alive. The tomb was empty because God said, I am not done yet. Amen. Jesus lives and will go on because I have conquered the power of death. That's the Easter story. That's the Easter memory, brothers and sisters. When we look into the empty tomb, we're reminded what Dee Cameron Murchison writes, and she wrote, be bold, my friends. Believe the signs that we hear in Scripture. Believe in what we receive in the history of the church. Celebrate and worship. Believe that the love of God is embodied in acts of love toward the world. The resurrection story, the Easter memories live on. We are a beloved community. We are free to believe in the resurrection. We are free to believe as Easter people. The power of God's love continues, she writes, to pervade the world undeterred by ways of death and destruction. Power of God, the love of God will not be deterred by what's going on. That's what we have to hold on fast to when we're in that in-between place, that place between belief, faith, and unbelief. We have to hold fast to that promise of God's love. Sisters and brothers in Christ, Easter memories are being created all the time when we hold on to that promise of God's love, because it propels us into the future. I know that God loves me. I know that God loves the world. I've experienced that in Scripture. I've experienced that in worship. I've experienced God's love being receiving the love and giving the love. I know this is what God means. And whenever a disciple of Jesus experiences or remembers the pain and suffering and death of the sting of loss, there is this opportunity for that love to penetrate that. No matter what's happening there, that somehow God's love can penetrate and break into that. And that, my friends, is the Easter story. The Easter story. The love of God in Christ breaking through what we thought or we believe or we feel is impenetrable. Sisters and brothers in Christ, Easter memories are being created all the time. Now and always is a time to remember the Easter story of God's power over death. Our task is to be those memory creators. The card industry, Hallmark, and all these industries, they claim that they can create memories. By buying a card? No. We, my friends, are memory creators. We are Easter memory creators. We can do things that will truly leave the signs of love and compassion and care and sympathy and joy and all those things that you can find in a Hallmark card. You and I, as Easter people, we can create memories. Amen. love of God in Christ of the risen one into the community, into the families, into the world. I want to be an Easter memory creator. I want you to be an Easter memory creator. I want this church to be known for its Easter memory creations.
Amen.
It's our task to be that. It's our task to be the people that have faith, that we can look into the face of death, the face of disappointment, the face of suffering, the face of poverty, the face of racism, the face of anything that would separate people of God from God's love. We can look at that face and we can say, we are not afraid of you. Because we have resurrection hope. We believe that there is something more for us, even in this moment, that God will bring to us if we believe. If we wonder, if we believe. The Gospel of John tells us that Mary stood outside the empty tomb. She was full of sorrow. She was weeping. And again, the angels of new creation showed up, two angels sitting on the tomb, and asked her, "Why are you crying? Why are you crying?" And she looked at them. She said, "I'm looking for the body of Jesus." She's looking for death. And then she saw another man who was standing behind, and she asked, "If you're the gardener, if you're the one that took away the body of Jesus, just tell me where that body is, and I'll go and I'll take care of it, I'll get it." And she's still crying, and she's still... And then she heard her name. Mary! She heard Jesus' voice with one word. She remembered the sound of Jesus' voice. She remembered her name being said. She had heard it before many times. She heard Jesus' voice and she realized there he was. It was true. And brothers and sisters, the risen Christ calls all of us by name. When you're in that place, that space in between belief and disbelief, I want you to listen. Because if you listen, I believe, with the ears of your heart, you will hear your name called by the risen Christ. You might have to wait 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 2 hours, whatever you need to do. You listen and you will be called because you are a beloved child of God. Child of the resurrection. Remember that. And take that message into the world. Remember Jesus' word. Remember his promise. Remember that he calls you by name, that you are a sheep of his flock, and that if you listen to his voice, you will hear him and you will follow him. And remember this. There is no power stronger than the power of God's love.
Amen.
That is at the core. That's the secret message, right? At the core of all Easter memories is that there is no power stronger than the power of God's love. Amen. If that's all you take into the world today, just take it. Go with it. Because it will be a message of hope and promise for Easter people and those who are wondering that are stuck in that space. You need to create that memory with it. Not for them, with them. With them. Create Easter memories. Go into the world, my brothers and sisters. Let us go together. Let us go as individuals. Let us not be afraid, but to be bold in our proclamation that Christ has risen. Christ is alive. Go and live in the good news. Christ is alive. Christ is risen and living right here in your heart and in my heart. And ready to go out into the world with us with this promise of the good news. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God's glory.